I put the role of gender in religion in the Taoism unit for a good reason. It's the only religion I know of that really places an equal emphasis on the male, the yang, and the yin, the female aspects of the taiji, or the symbol of Taoism. Also, we see in Taoism that women were shamans and the like. Women could be clergy in Taoism, and it's also notable that Taoism's among the few religions that will see something like menstrual flow as a symbol of the Tao, rather than as a defiling and impure practice. And it's interesting that among the religions, Taoism has traditionally viewed things like menstrual flow as a symbol of the life-giving Tao, rather than a reason for defilement or impurity or the need to seclude women from society during these periods. When we look at women and religion, we can go back to the tribal phase, where it's pretty common to see women shamanesses. With the rise of civilization in our unit on ancient civilizations, we saw the emergence of a strong patriarch. It should be said that one thing that differentiates Homo sapiens, for example, from the Neanderthals is that the Neanderthal hunters all hunted together, men and women. Homo sapiens divided their labor into jobs for women, like agriculture, and jobs for men, like hunting. And so with the rise of the ancient city-states, we see patriarchy firmly ensconced in the religious practices as we see them evinced in things like the laws of Hammurabi, where we see much more harsh penalties for women than for men. Likewise, it's unheard of, almost, to hear of women rulers of ancient city-states. So we can really pinpoint the suppression of women in religion, formally at least, back to 5,000 or so BCE and the emergence of modern civilizations eventually. When we look at those religions of ancient city-states, then we certainly have a clear differentiation of men from women. In the tribal religions even, there's often the idea of heaven as male, fertilizing the earth as a feminine figure. In the ancient city-states, we see women with clearly defined roles. Some of them are warlike, like Kali, the Hindu goddess, a manifestation of Durga's wrath. We see Athena defending the city of Athens with her armor and the like. But then also we see women depicted as Aphrodite or Artemis. And again, these ancient city-states religions pattern the divine world after the human world we all know. So some of the male gods are more feminine than some of the female gods, who are more masculine than some of the male gods. Nevertheless, though, as much as people like to fantasize about a matriarchal tribal society, it still seems pretty clear patriarchy goes back to the beginnings of Homo sapiens. We can think, then again, in Taoist terms, the Tao is male and female, therefore neither strictly male nor strictly female, but an integrated whole of both genders. When we look at the Abrahamic religions, however, we'll see masculine features ascribed to first Jehovah or Yahweh in Judaism, and then in Christianity it is considered the Father God who's head of the Trinity. Islam refers to Allah, the God, in masculine terms, but really as a pronoun. Allah is said to be beyond gender. In Hinduism, we saw the ferocious goddesses, but it should be noted that Hindu women had to worship their husbands as gods. Even in the past, though illegal now, they were to throw their bodies on the burning funeral pyres of their husbands at death to follow the guy into the next life. There's no real divorce in Hinduism. Even death does not do you part. So socially, we saw with the Indian religion's units, Buddhism presented an out for women. They could be nuns now, or beggaresses, the more proper term. Some of the hymns of the early beggaresses were all about leaving that jerk behind. And thanks to Buddha, we can read and write and practice and not be confined to the household. Buddhism in India then parallels Taoism in being relatively pro-woman. That is not the case with the yang side, if you will, of Chinese society, Confucianism, where the husband is the head of the household, the emperor is a male, the number one son is the most valued offspring. Even Plato had the idea that the two genders were once one whole that subsequently split into male and female. In most all the religions, however, we'll see segregation of men and women. In Judaism and Islam, classical Christianity, there are separate places for men and women to sit, for example. A menstruating woman was not allowed even to attend the service in classical Judaism. Even a man is not allowed to sit on the seat of a menstruating woman. There is one angle, though, where women certainly have always played a major role in religions, even in this times of patriarchy. And I find those heroes or heroines are to be found in the mothers of some of our famous religious figures. I'm doubting the Buddha would have been the Buddha without the love and attention of Prajapati, his stepmother. And I know for a fact Confucius would not have succeeded to the heights he did as the cultural face of China were it not for his poor, hard-working, single mom. So while we don't know their names, their contributions are there. We see in the ministry of Jesus, it was the women who failed to run away, but his male disciples ran away and denied him. According to the Gospel of Mary, Christ loved Mary most of all. We can say that male power rested at one time on brute strength, but in modern times, we can see the emergence of women as national leaders, business leaders, and the like. In the modern world, processing small items at a fast pace, like with computers, or multitasking. These are features that come with that historical role women played in agriculture. So there's no need for women to wield a giant spear. We can see with Angelina Jolie and the like, a woman can wield an Uzi just fine. So in modern times, we see women clergy in Judaism, Christianity, even sometimes as well in Islam. But Taoism always seems to have included the feminine side of reality quite directly and foremost. In Taoist tradition, it's even recommended that men take on women's roles and vice versa from time to time in order to attain that perfect balance of yin and yang. It is a religion, relatively speaking, without rules. And so, unlike many traditions, we don't see the castigation of the homosexual and the like. I think the motto of Taoism might be, if it feels good, do it. It's your nature, and nature is never wrong. According to the Taoists, the Tao manifests all things, good, evil, and neutral. So fortunately, we can say the future for women is very bright. I once attended a conference and a woman objected. "Things are terrible, professor," she said, "for women." The professor agreed. "It's not a fair world yet by any means," he said. But he noted that 100 years ago, she could not even have been in that classroom. So women are always there in all the religions. But in some, of course, they're more oppressed, I'd argue, than in others of them. And the masculine is privileged in some more than others, and certainly in this Chinese case of Taoism. As noted feminist scholar Mary Daly said, God's plan is often a cover for men's plan.